Isn't God good? It's good to be in the presence of the Lord and just give Him thanksgiving. Give Him our worship and praise this morning. Heavenly Father, just have Your way in this place. Be in this moment. Be in our time together. We say, Lord Jesus, work and move. Work and move in our hearts and in our lives. And we give You praise. We give You glory. And everybody said, amen. Let's worship Him.
In the presence of my enemies, I'll raise a hallelujah, louder than my unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah, my weapon is a melody.
Singing when So feel the warmth of your embrace.
Jesus, help me find a way and bring me back to you. Cause you're all I want. Cause you're all I've ever needed. Cause you're all I want. Cause help me know you are near. Cause you're all. You're all I've ever needed. Cause you're all that I want. Cause help me know you are near. Cause you are my desire. Let's make that our prayer today. Cause no one else will do. Cause nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Cause help me find a way and bring me back to you. Cause you're all I want. Cause you're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Cause help me know you are near. You're all I want. Cause you're all I've ever needed. Cause you're all I want. Cause help me you're all I want. Cause you're all I've ever needed. Cause you're all I want. Cause help me know you are near.
Lord, you are all we want. You are all we want this morning, God. We thank you that we know that you are near. Lord, help us recognize, realize, and appreciate the fact that you are near. Lord, we love you this morning. Jesus, we praise you. And Lord, on this holiday, God, Jesus, we recognize that you died for us too. Except the freedom that we have because you died for us, it's not based on a country. It's not based on a military might. But it was all based on you choosing to love us so much that you died for us. But you didn't stay dead, Lord. You rose again, and you are alive, and you are living, and our hope is in you. So Jesus, we honor you this morning. We recognize and we appreciate the fact that we find freedom in you that is not temperamental, that is reliant upon no one but you. And Lord, we worship you in that freedom this morning. We love you, Jesus.
The chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving tore through the shadow of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. In Jesus Christ, my living hope.
What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah, praise the one who sets me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Then came the that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe, and out of the silence the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your
out of the silence, the roaring lion declares that the grave has no claim on me. Oh, Jesus, yours is the victory.
Come on.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who sets me free. Hallelujah. Death has this grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who sets me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, you're my living hope.
Let's sing verse 3 again and just declare it today.
And then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Just then came the morning,
and then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe, and out of the silence,
come on,
the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Oh, Jesus, yours is the victory.
Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who sets me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me.
Hallelujah, praise the one who sets me free. Hallelujah,
death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain.
There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my Lord.
Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Church, I don't know about you, but that's exciting news. That is exciting news that the grave was open. Death was no longer anything we had to fear. Jesus has won the victory. That's a shout. Hallelujah, if there ever was one. I don't know. Y'all are looking like a little asleep today. Can we shout hallelujah? Come on, hallelujah. We don't have to fear death, hell, and the grave. We can be excited that today is Independence Day. We can be excited for our free nation. But church, it doesn't matter what nation you live in Jesus, you are free. And you need to get excited and shout about that. We need to be excited that no matter what our search situation and our circumstances, when we call on the name of the Lord, we are saved. Jesus, we worship you today. We give you honor and praise and glory and adoration because you are worthy, because you have defeated death, hell, and the grave, because God so loved us that God sent his son for us so that we can be saved, forgiven, set free. Lord Jesus, we worship you today. God, we set our eyes on you today. We want to hear from you. We want to talk to you. We want to be in communion with you today. Lord, we want to be changed by you, by your Spirit today. So we invite you, Holy Spirit, to come and have your way in our life today. Come and have your way in this service today. We give you permission, we give you access, and we just say, come and have your way today. Open our ears to hear, our hearts to receive, our eyes to see what it is you're saying, and make our feet ready to respond to you. We love you. We worship you. In your name we pray. Amen.
I think it would be good for us today on this 4th of July. Can you stand with me? The Bible says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord's. And we want to take the opportunity this morning and just thank God for not only the freedoms that he's given us, but we want to ask him to continue to bless and change us. You know, we need to focus on him. We need to ask him to come in and be Lord in spots. And so just thought it would be good for us today to lift up the name of God and thank him for the privilege that we have to live where we live. We're very grateful for that. So why don't you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I thank you so much this morning for just this Independence Day, this opportunity that we have as Americans to live in the United States of America, the land of the free. And God, we're so grateful for the opportunity that has been afforded to us to be here. Lord Jesus, we do pray, God, that you would bless America. We do pray that you would work in hearts and in lives. And Holy Spirit, that you would be magnified. Lord, the Bible says that if we will call on you, if we will hear, that you will hear from heaven, you will heal our land and forgive our sins. And Lord, I just pray today that you'll forgive us of our trespasses. Forgive us of some of the mistakes that we've made and the things that we've done wrong. And we pray, Jesus, that you would be Lord of all in the United States of America. Lord, that we would be an example of righteousness and not unrighteousness. But God, we would point to you, the Savior of all mankind, that you came and died for each and every one so that they can be free and they can know you. Lord, we ask for revival to come to America. We pray that you would sweep through the nation, Lord, from the east to the west, from the north to the south. God, start in Alaska. And Lord, do something big in the hearts and the lives of the United States of Americans this year in 2021. We're asking for that in the name of Jesus. Lord, we are grateful and we are thankful for our heritage and we're thankful for our history. And God, we've learned a lot of lessons in the past. Lord, I pray that we won't forget those things, but Lord, help us to remember, number one, that you are faithful and that in God we trust at all times. And in God we put our hope and we put our faith, and Lord, we're secure in you. Lord, touch everyone today all across the country. God, begin to do a great work. Lord, we thank you for those that have sacrificed for us. We thank you for the privilege that we have to be Americans. Lord, I pray this morning your blessing upon each and every person. And God, we do choose to recognize you. But we do say, Lord God, we need you. We really need you. We need you in a great and powerful way. So God, would you do it? Would you do big things? And we stand together as a church, as the body of Christ, asking for the Lord to work and move in mighty ways that we have never seen or ever heard of, in Jesus' name, exceedingly abundantly, infinitely beyond our highest prayers, Lord, in Jesus' name, for your purpose and your glory. We love you, Jesus, and we thank you. And God bless the United States of America, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. It's good to have you. You may be seated. Excited to have our kids on Family Sunday. You know what? We had an outstanding VBS this week. It was a lot of fun. We learned a lot of cool things. I met some people there, and I got some friends. They're going to visit us this morning. If they're around here somewhere, they said they wanted to come and be a part of our Sunday morning service. Oh, there he is. Let's give Klaus a hand, and he's got his crew here.
No. I could have sworn I had the multiply right. Or was I supposed to carry the root? It doesn't make any sense. Boo!
Oh, Dr. Roberts, are you sad? Because you know what? This is not a sad chair. This is my happy chair. Yeah.
Right now, every chair I sit in is a sad chair.
Oh, that means we need to spin it out of you, yeah.
Spin what out? The sadness?
Yeah, every time I get sad, like when we ran out of corn dogs, oh, I spin in the chair every day. You ready?
What is up with you and corn dogs? Ah!
Spin! Oh, now! Is the sadness gone? You feel better?
I can't tell if I'm sad or just dizzy.
Oh, well, let's just take a deep breath. Take a deep breath, take a moment, and we'll talk about it, okay? Now, what is on your mind?
I can't figure out this problem with Wonderbot. I've tried everything, and it just keeps hiccuping.
Hiccuping?
Yes, hiccuping.
Oh, that's crazy. What about your gifts?
Well, I can't figure out this problem. It's like all my knowledge is fleeing my mind, like something like something with wings that fly.
Like a bird?
Yes, see? I'm losing all my knowledge.
No, you're not losing all your knowledge. Your wonderful brain is your gift from God.
Gifts are supposed to be used.
But you are using your gifts.
Well, I thought I was. Well, I thought I was, but, I mean, how can I use my gift if my gift isn't working? And I need to, and I still need to fan it into flame.
What did you say?
I said fan it into flame. What are you doing?
Did you say fire, fan into flame?
Yes. Yeah,
yes,
but...
Yes, we will set your hair on fire and fan your flame of gift to God.
I don't like this. Hold on.
Yeah?
To fan something into flame is an expression. Oh. It means to use your God-given gifts rather than hide them away.
Oh, I think I get it now. So we all have gifts from God, and we are to use them to help others?
But how do I know for sure? Yeah, I know, but how do I know for sure? How do I know it's not just something I'm good at?
See, the difference between something you're just good at and something that is a gift from God is that the gift is something you can use to help others. Yeah.
Yeah, well, I suppose I have used my gift to help quite a bit. I mean, with Wonderbot here.
Yeah. You know what? I could not have completed the calculations on Wonderbot without your help. You helped me a lot.
Okay, but I'm still not sure what to do here. I've taken a look at these numbers like a million times.
Oh, look. Can I take a look?
Sure. I hope you can make sense of what I wrote.
Why don't you step out of your chair? Let's take a look at it together. Okay, I don't understand this. Is this English? This looks more like maybe Japanese or Klingon or maybe Romulan.
I think it's upside down.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Now we're getting nowhere. I still don't understand it. Hey, how about I just carry this around a little bit and check it out?
What did you just say?
Well, I wonder if I could just carry it around.
Oh, I can't believe it. I forgot to carry the 5, giving me the right equation for Wonderbot. You helped me.
Yeah, let's input some numbers and see if it works.
Okay, let's see here.
And voila! Whoa! Wonderbot, no!
Oh, great, now what?
Well, you know what? It's okay. This is okay. We will use the gifts God gave us to help solve this new problem. Okay? But first, we must cast Wonderbot. Wonderbot!
Oh, amen. Let's give him a hand. They did a great job this week at VBS. It was wonderful. We spent one evening talking about the gifts of God and what God wants to do in our lives. And I want us to go that direction this morning. We're going to be in Acts chapter 9. But first of all, if we look at our text today, the Bible says, "For you have been called to live in freedom, brothers and sisters." And the last part of that verse says, "Use your freedom to serve." How many of you know service is a gift? Hospitality is a gift. Use your freedom to serve one another. Now, we see this in the book of Acts. We see this in Acts chapter 9, verse 32, with Peter. And God uses Peter in great and mighty ways. But there's an individual in a community that is really sick and has passed away. And she was a person who used her gifts and served others. She used her freedom to serve others. The people within the community. So let's go ahead and read verse 32, Acts chapter 9. It says, "As Peter traveled about the country, he went to visit the Lord's people who lived in Lydda, where he found a man named Aeneas, who was paralyzed and had been bedridden for 8 years. Aeneas," Peter said to him, "Jesus Christ heals you. Get up and roll up your mat." Immediately, Aeneas got up, and all those who lived in Lydda and Sharon saw him and turned to the Lord. Look what it says. It says that they all turned to God. God did a great work. God did a great miracle here. And people received the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 36, it says, "In Joppa there was a disciple named Tabitha. In Greek, her name is Dorcas. And she was always doing good and helping the poor. And about that time, she became ill and she died. And her body was washed and placed in an upstairs room. Lydda was near Joppa, so when the disciples heard that Peter was in Lydda, he sent 2 men to him and urged him, 'Please come at once.'" They had heard about what God had done with Peter and how God was using him, and they called out for Peter. Peter went with them, and when he arrived, he was taken upstairs to the room, and all the widows stood round him, crying and showing him the robes and all of the other clothing that Dorcas had made while she was still with them. Peter sent them out of the room, and then he got down on his knees and he prayed. And turning toward the dead woman, he said, 'Tabitha, get up.' And she opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. He took her by the hand and helped her to her feet. Then he called for the believers, especially the widows, and presented her to them alive. And this became known all over Joppa, and many people believed in the Lord. Let me pray this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the reading of your word. We thank you for the story of God. And Lord, that you have great things in store for each of us. You want to use us, and you have a plan and a purpose in our life. Lord, I pray we would capture today the plan that God has for us, the purpose God has for us. As we read the word, as we teach and preach, Lord, may you be glorified, and may the presence of the Holy Spirit have his way in this place. And everybody said, amen. Praise the Lord. Dorcas made an enormous impact on her community. It says, by always doing good and helping the poor, by making robes, by making clothing. And when she died, the room was filled with mourners. Most likely the people that she had helped, that she had sowed life into. And when she was brought back to life, the Bible says that the news raced throughout the town, throughout the entire region. Listen, God has a purpose for each and every one of us. And God wants to use us. If we were to ask the question, what is God's purpose for me? You know, what is this salvation for? Okay, well, we just got done reading our text in Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. It says we're called to live in freedom. And it says use your freedom to serve. Use your freedom to talk about what Jesus wants to do in people's hearts and lives and how he wants to change them. And so as God worked through Peter, God used Peter, the missionary, the evangelist. God worked through him to heal and raise the dead. But God was also working through Tabitha. He was also working through Dorcas with her deeds of kindness and love. And one of the things that we see in Scripture, the example, is that kindness always starts with seeing. It always starts with opening our eyes to the things that's going on around us. It's learning to observe the state that we are in and the struggles that people are dealing with. You know, there's hurting people all around us, all over the world. Some live next door. Some of them walk by you at work. There are hurting people sitting next to you in church. And we need to be able to see. We need to see what God wants to do in them. Because God has given us the answer, amen? He's given us the answer. So our prayer should be, Lord, help me to see. Help me to see people. The Bible says, never walk away from someone who deserves help. Your hand is the hand of God for that person. So acts of love, acts of kindness, acts of generosity, acts of love that help those in need, they are as much a manifestation of the Holy Spirit as are the gift of miracles, signs, and wonders. Peter said it like this. If you go to the 1 Peter chapter 4, you see it in his letter. This is one of the things that he points out. Verse 7, it says, the end of all things is near. Therefore, be alert of sober mind so that you may pray. He says, above all, love each other deeply because love covers a multitude of sin. That's a verse that we're familiar with. But verse 9, it says, offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. And then look what he says. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in the various forms, all the many forms of God's grace, kindness, goodness, love, mercy, the ministry of helps, and the ministry of service. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so in the strength that God provides. So that in all things, and look at this, because this is the main part. This is the point, that in all things, God may be praised through Jesus Christ. Amen. All of us are called. Every one of us. And we learned that this last week at VBS. Our 39 kids in the altar learned that all of us are called. All of us are called. We're called to know him. We're called to love him. We're called to follow him with all of our hearts. We're called to be hospitable and loving and kind, to be people of mercy. It's God's grace in its various forms. The Bible talks a lot about spiritual gifts. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, it says, a spiritual gift is given to each of us so that we can help each other. God has gifted you so that you can be a help to someone. And listen, the gifts are necessary. They're absolutely 100% necessary to thrust us into the mission work of Jesus Christ, so that people can know the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. The purpose of the Spirit is to exalt Jesus and the mission of Jesus, that Jesus is lifted up. And the Bible talks about how the gifts are varied. There's so many different kinds of gifts of the Spirit that we see in the Bible. The body of Christ, all filled with the Holy Spirit, all giving expression through the gifts of God. The full Pentecostal work in the body of Christ. Every single part has a role. And I love that our example in Scripture, I mean, we see this here in Acts chapter 9. But our greatest example in Scripture is Christ. Christ is our example. Jesus taught us that the purpose is about relationship. Okay, in Luke chapter 19, verse 10, Jesus said, I have come to seek and save those that are lost. In Matthew chapter 20, verse 28, Jesus said, I have come to serve and give. In Ephesians chapter 4, we see that God talks about how Jesus came to show grace. It says in verse 7, yet grace, God's undeserved favor, was given. It was the character of Jesus. It was the privilege of Jesus. Come on, somebody. It was the opportunity that Jesus had. In Jesus, we always see that he loves people and invests in people and he believes in them. And then he challenges us. And you know the challenge in Matthew chapter 28. Therefore, go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and in the name of the Son and in the name of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Tell everybody about everything that I have been talking about and that I have been commanding you, and I am with you always to the very end of the age. I love that God is someone that is always going. He is a go God. Listen, he says, go into all the world. He says, go, your faith has healed you. Jesus says, go and sin no more. Come on, we have a generation and we have a world that needs to hear these words. Jesus would say, we have a church that needs to understand, go and do likewise. Go, he's a go God. And when Jesus tells the church to go into all nations, okay, he's not just clearly talking about countries. That's part of it. Listen, we need to go into countries. We need to go into multiple countries. And we need to baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But when he's talking about all nations, he's talking about all kinds of people. He's talking about all kinds of people groups. Go into all the people groups and baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Look for the possibility. The possibilities for God to do big things and amazing things. I love that in this story in verse 38. It says the disciples heard. Say the disciples heard. The disciples heard that Peter was in Lydda and sent two men to him and urged him, please come at once. What was maybe would seem as a chance encounter was God's plan. It was God ordering steps. We've been talking about how God orders our steps the last few weeks. It was a God-engineered moment, a God-engineered counter for the gospel to be preached and for people to see that Jesus Christ saves and Jesus Christ heals. Listen, we in the Assemblies of God, we talk a lot about missions, and one of the big slogans we have is everyone can pray, everyone can give, and everyone can go. But listen, let me tell you this morning, everyone can be used too. I want to add to that, you can be used. And I absolutely love that Christ gives us the power to live for him now. To live for him now. And he gives us the hope and he gives us the future. One of the best promises in the Bible is Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Listen, God sees every single person and he has plans to give them a hope and a future. You may be sitting next to somebody that says, I don't have a lot of hope. I don't have a lot of future. God has plans to give you a hope and a future. It is for freedom that we have been set free. Remember that with God, we're all called to infinitely more. Infinitely more than we can ask, think, or imagine, according to his purpose at work within us. This requires us to answer the call and to participate. Okay, not sit on the sidelines, but be involved. And say, Lord, where am I involved in your kingdom? Where do I need to be involved in your kingdom? And I'm not just talking about ministry in the church. Okay, that's important. But there's multiple opportunities to be involved in the kingdom of God in this world. God has a big plan for your life. He sees you with incredible potential. He knows what you're capable of. He wants to work on the inside of you. And listen, the more we become like Jesus, the more we will serve. And the more we will love. Paul said to the church of Corinth, and I love this passage. We're going to take communion this morning here in a minute with Pastor Aubrey. And we're going to break the bread and we're going to drink the cup. But what we see in this passage is Paul teaches the church, and he says it like this. He says, I've received from the Lord Jesus Christ, and I pass it on to you. What was he doing? He was giving what he had. He was investing. It goes back to Acts chapter 3. Such as I have, give I thee in the name of Jesus Christ. Rise up and walk. You know what's so cool about this story in Acts chapter 9? It reminds me of the story in the Gospels when Jesus went to heal the young man, Jairus' son. And everybody was crying and everybody was wailing. And Jesus put everybody outside the room and rose him, except for mom and dad, rose him from the dead. And we see that with Peter. Peter does that here, places everybody outside the room. It's like he's using the example that Christ was for him. Paul says, I have something, and I want you to have it. In Acts chapter 20, he says, my life is worth nothing. Look at this. Nothing. It's nothing. Unless I use it for doing the work. Unless I use it. Are you doing the work this morning? Are you doing the work that God has assigned you by Christ Jesus? The work of telling the good news about God's wonderful kindness and love. Listen, it's never the purpose of the Lord, and you've heard me say this, to have the Holy Spirit come into our church services and touch us and fill us up and leave us here. It's not about coming in and having a Holy Ghost moment, Holy Ghost time, and then we go out and do nothing. It's never the purpose of the Spirit to do that. Now, he wants to heal you. Come on. He wants to touch you. He wants to fill you up. But it is for the use of taking the gospel of Jesus Christ to those that are out there, to those that don't know Christ. It's not about simply having the Spirit stir us in worship and then leave us here on a Sunday morning or a Wednesday and we walk out and don't do anything different. No, we come and we get filled and we get changed and then we walk it out in Jesus' name. We walk out the life he's called us to walk out. We step into the anointing that he's given us. We function in the gift. We take the steps of faith and we do the things God's called us to do. That's what we are called to do. We have the mandate to spread the truth, to value the things that Jesus values. Jesus said, as the Father sent me, I'm sending you. I'm sending you. You've heard me say before that the ship is designed for the ocean, not the harbor. Get the boat out into the ocean. And let's save people. Let's help people. Let's give them the gospel so they can ask Jesus into their life. God saves us. And then he equips us. He calls us to the holy work. He uses us. You need to realize that you're all created for ministry. Kids, you're created for ministry. You learned that this week with Dr. Klaus and Dr. Will Robinson. You learned that this week. You're created for ministry. You're saved for ministry. Okay, if you're not doing ministry, you're not fulfilling your role in the kingdom. I'm going to say it again. If you're not doing ministry, you're not fulfilling your role in the kingdom. You're saved for ministry. You're called into the ministry. You're gifted for ministry. Come on. You're commanded to minister. We just got done reading that. And you're prepared to minister. You've got the answer. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. And you're needed for ministry. And you're accountable and rewarded according to your ministry. You have a ministry. God designed you. Say, He designed me to make a difference. He designed me to make a difference. Listen, our investment in another's life is always an eternal investment. When you remember that, Paul would say, for the love of Christ compels me. God has called us to be people of mercy and grace and kindness. Verse 15 of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I just want to read this to you. Verse 14 says, for Christ's love compels me. Verse 15, and He died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves. We don't live for ourselves, but for Him who died for them and has raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ this way, we do so no longer. And then a couple of my favorite verses in Scripture. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone. Come on, the new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to Himself, and He gave us the ministry of reconciliation, helping people understand that they can be redeemed, they can be restored, they can be made whole. So why are we here? What is my role? What is my purpose? What is salvation for? You are called to live in freedom. Amen. You are called to live in freedom. On this 4th of July weekend, we're going to hear the word freedom a lot. You are called to live in freedom. The freedom that Christ has for you. You're called. We know what freedom is in America. We understand what freedom is. In the kingdom of heaven, you are called to freedom. Free from sin. Jesus Christ, the living hope. You are called to live in freedom, but use your freedom. Use it. Use it. Use your freedom to serve. Use your freedom to talk about Jesus to other people and to help. To be a helper like Dorcas, a person who did things for the community, a person who would make clothes for the community. What was she doing? She was functioning in her gift, doing great things and helping people. Ask God how He wants you to contribute and be a part in the kingdom of God. Jesus said it like this. Jesus said, the greatest commandment is to love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And the second greatest commandment is to love your neighbor as yourself. And He said, all the law of the prophets hang on these two commands. It's pretty simple. It's love God, and it's love people. His love has and always will endure. And you can love people with the love of God. Amen? You can love all people with the love of God. Here's the thing. Salvation is Jesus. It's His idea. Because we were all messed up and lost. We didn't have freedom. We were in chains. We were broken. We were messed up. But it is for freedom that Christ has set me free. No longer to be entangled in the chains of sin. Amen? When we engage in the relationships, the loving the neighbor, we participate in something that's far greater than our own ability to affect another person. We're actually participating in the fabric that unites us as God's creation. In other words, it comes back to that our investment in another person's life is always an eternal investment. Let's go back and read our scripture. Pastor Aubrey's going to come, and we're gonna take communion here. But Acts chapter 9, verse 39, and we'll read our passage again. Peter went with them, and when he arrived, he was taken upstairs to the room, and all the widows stood around him crying and showing showing him the robes and the clothing that Dorcas had made, showing him the impact that she had had on their life. That was fruit. They were showing him the fruit of the impact that she had. And it says in verse 40 that Peter sent them out of the room, and then he got down on his knees and prayed. And turning towards the dead woman, he said, "Get up." She opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. And then in verse 42, it says, many people believed. Many people believed. For you have been called to live in freedom. Use your freedom to serve one another. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the relationship that we can have with Jesus. Thank you so much that it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. We thank you, Jesus, that you are the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus, you are the living hope this morning. And God, we praise you and thank you so much for salvation that is found in no other man, no other person, only the Lord Jesus Christ. And today we celebrate and we remember, God, the great things that you've done for us. That you died on the cross for our sins. God, you made it possible for us to be used and partner with you in great things. God, you gave us a seat at the Lord's table. And we thank you for that. We thank you that we are heirs and co-heirs with Christ Jesus. We thank you that we are adopted sons and daughters of God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the freedom that you've given us.
Let's stand up this morning as we get ready to receive communion together. Is there anyone here that has not, we've got some in the very back, maybe in the overflow. I know, Kathy, there's some. Let's. I was watching live stream of a friend's wedding yesterday, and one thing that the pastor said to the couple after they put the exchanged rings was that rings are a symbol, right? The ring itself does not make you married, but the rings are a symbol, and the rings are a reminder to the couple that no matter what, no matter where they are, if they're not together, if one of them is in a different place, if they're at work or they're in a different state or, you know, travel, whatever, when they're not together, you can always look at your hand and know that you are with each other. That's a symbol, that's a reminder that even though we're apart, we're together. And then they took communion together as a couple. And I thought that was just a really cool thing, because then he likened it to this, and he said that when we receive communion, Jesus told us to do this to remember me. Remember me. This is a symbol. It's just a symbol. But it reminds us that Jesus is with us. It reminds us of what Jesus did for us. It reminds us that we are loved by God. It reminds us that God so loved us that he sent his son to the world to save us. So when we come here on the first Sunday of the month, on Family Sunday, and we receive communion, we're doing it to remember what God has done. It's a symbol of the love that Jesus has for us. It's a covenant that he has entered into with us. Just like the marriage covenant, he has entered into this covenant with us. And that covenant, church, we can't amend it. We can't change it. He made this covenant with his blood for us, with us. And it's a covenant that says you can be forgiven. It's a covenant that says I am with you. It says I have a plan for you. It says you too can be part of my family. It's covenant that says you used to be on the outside and now you're on the inside. It's very, very significant. And so as we get ready this morning to receive communion together, let's do it remembering that Jesus loves us so much, that he is with us. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, it says, I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself, that on the night that he was betrayed, he took some bread and he gave thanks to God for it, and he broke it into pieces and he said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this to remember me. Let's close our eyes and let's remember. Jesus, we remember the gift that you gave us, the covenant that you made with us. When your body was sacrificed for us, it was beaten, it was nailed to a cross, it hung there for everyone to see. Because you love us. Because you loved us when you came and you love us now. Because you desire to be in relationship with us. Because you want to forgive us. You want us to receive your gift of salvation. And so today we remember that. We remember your gift. Church, let's take the bread together in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And the verse continues, the chapter continues. And it says, in the same way that Jesus took the cup of wine after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this to remember me. Again, Lord, that word covenant, you are a covenant maker, a promise keeper. You do not go back on your word with us. And Lord, that day you made a covenant with your blood that says that salvation is ours, that says that we don't have to fear death, hell, and the grave any longer, that said you are victorious, and that we can be part of that, that if we call on your name, we are saved. We are made whole in you. That we can have forgiveness of sins and life everlasting. And the amazing gift of your Spirit that you sent to do life with us, to help us make right choices, to hear you, to follow you. And so today we remember and we recognize and we acknowledge and we appreciate what you've done for us. Church, let's take the cup in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Lord Jesus, we love you. God, we worship you. We give you praise for this day, for what you've done. God, I'm thankful to you that you have gifted us so we can be part of your story. You've gifted us to go and to tell and to preach and to disciple and to serve those around us. God, give us eyes to see. Help us to slow down enough to take the opportunities that you've put in front of us. We love you. I pray that as we go out today, as we celebrate together, that you would be with us. Bless the food. Bless our fellowship today, God. And we just pray that you'd send us out in the power and the might of your Holy Spirit today, that we would that we would lead and we would walk and we would talk the way that you've called us to. We love you. In your name we pray, amen, church.
Hey, good morning, North Pole Assembly of God. It's been great having you with us today. Hope you enjoyed the service. Just a reminder, there's a couple different ways you can give. You can give online at northpoleag.org, or you can give by mail, North Pole Assembly of God, 503 Kitt Boulevard, 99705. We're praying for you. We hope you have a great week. God bless you.